Now, they didn't really need to do a survey. They should have just asked me, or in fact you, or in fact any parent of a teenager. Most of them are checking their mobile phones after they've been sent to bed. That means their sleep is being disrupted, and what a surprise, they're tired at school and probably pretty grumpy. Well, let's have a look at the figures and the findings in a little more detail. 45% check their phones after lights out. Now, some children were looking at least 10 times every night. Almost all were on, as you would expect, social media. Well, let's talk about this for the next few minutes because Janelle Hoffman is with us. Now, she made headlines when she gave her son a phone with an 18-point contract. She's in Massachusetts in the US, and here in the studio is Emma Robertson from Digital Awareness UK and also Mike Buchanan from the Headmasters and Headmistresses Conference, who jointly did this survey. Thanks all of you for being here with us. I'm absolutely fascinated in this one. Emma, to you, first of all, I know I was rather rude about the blindingly obviously bit, but actually when I read the findings of this, there were quite a few surprises.
Yeah, there were some surprises in there. And, you know, we do know that this stuff is happening, but actually when you see those statistics up on the screen just like that, you realise just how disruptive technology has become when it comes to young people being able to sleep and being alert and awake at school the next day and all those sorts of
and
things.
And what they're doing, yes. The social media, the films, the music, their parents not knowing, all of that contained within this. Let's bring in Janelle, because Janelle, you're an absolute genius, because I've read what you've done. This is absolutely fantastic. And I absolutely loved the points you put down in this 18-point contract. I mean, just tell our viewers some of them, the top lines.
Sure, absolutely. So it leads with, it is my phone, I bought it, I am loaning it to you, aren't I the greatest? And then that one really wanted to set the tone for this idea that the technology is a privilege and it's not a right, and we're going to learn this together. And then certainly there were some other points that included specific times that I wanted my son to turn it off. And also some less measurable points, which was, you know, if you wouldn't say it to somebody in person, don't put it over this device. You know, a lot of those points that I really wanted to enhance his character and his digital character in particular, allowing him to really be thoughtful and mindful about how the technology was going to be in his life. And from the parent angle, really thinking about the whole child and how we can have a healthy relationship to technology. Yeah.
You did it beautifully, because some of the points, I just picked out one where you say, I love you madly and I want to share millions of texts with you, before you actually went on to put a few sort of rather tougher points to him. Now, I think he was 13 at the time, your son. What did he make of it? What was his first reaction?
Well, I think when we sat down together before it went on the internet and before we shared it with a more public audience, you know, he really just felt like it was reasonable, and it was, which a lot of people don't believe necessarily, but he felt like it was a reflection of our family. You know, he said to me, Mom, this is just so us, right? And that really summarized that how we were parenting digitally and how the technology was in our life is really consistent to the rest of our family values and the foundational principles that are really important to us as a family. And of course, those are going to apply to how we parent digitally.
That's really funny, because when he went on television, he apparently said, oh my God, why? So a different conversation with you. Let me bring in my other guest here, Mike Buchanan, who's been listening to all of this, because in a sense, you get all the backwash, don't you, of all of this that's going on with pupils arriving at school pretty tired.
Yeah, there are some. I don't want to overemphasise the negative bits of this survey. Actually, most teenagers are perfectly capable of managing their digital lives without any great impact at all.
But is this something that teachers have begun to notice creeping in, do you think?
Yeah, there are times when children are nodding off. That might be because they're tired using their digital phones. It could be, of course, that they're not terribly interested. But so it's something we've got to be aware of. And the reason we did this survey together was to give us some data that allows us to open a new conversation with parents about doing exactly what Janelle's
suggesting. What about the conversation with pupils? Are you able to work in different bits of advice, or do they say to you, well, what's that got to do with you?
So teenagers generally respond to the models that are around them. So the key thing about whether it's at home or at school is having adults around who are modelling the behaviour you're expecting. So we don't allow the adults, for instance, to be using their mobile phones whilst they're sitting at lunch having their lunch. And the same would be true for the youngsters. You know, you can use your digital device in lessons if it's used for learning, but not for going on Snapchat or Facebook.
Emma, I mean, it goes without saying that their sleep is being disrupted. I mean, they're not sleeping if they're listening to music or watching films. But there's also that whole area of blue light exposure. So in a sense, it's a double whammy, isn't it, in terms of if they are using their phones when they're in bed?
Yeah, it really is. And, you know, people will say, well, TV's been around for years and we've been watching that during the night. And I used to listen to the radio throughout the evening. But this is different. It's very different.
And that's explain because, why it's different.
Well, you've got issues like blue light, which, so for anyone who's not aware of what that is, when you're using a digital device, you have a specific type of light that gets emitted and it really stifles the hormone that makes you feel sleepy and want to go to sleep. There are devices like the Apple device that have a night shift mode that you can click and everything goes a bit yellow, and it means that, you know, you're not subjected to as much blue light. But absolutely, it's not just the fact that things are buzzing and pinging and going off through the night, it's also the fact that you're exposed to things that just aren't going to help you
sleep. So what would your advice be both to teenagers and parents? Because I'm going to confess that I have at different stages taken out the whole router so nothing works in the house in order to try and stop this, and of course I routinely fail.
Of course. And it's so interesting speaking to parents because there are so many different tactics that they're using to try and get this right. And for some parents, you know, having a contract is absolutely spot on. It will work with them. For others, having a tech bucket that sits in the kitchen. Actually, I was talking to the taxi driver on the way down here and he's saying, yep, we've got our tech bucket. Everyone puts their devices in there at 8 o'clock.
I'm going to write that down. That's very good.
And that includes me, it includes my wife, it includes all of our kids.
Oh, it includes you as well.
Because, like we're saying,
keen on that. You know, I'll put a question mark there on that.
You have to, you have to set the precedent. You have to be role models. But actually, when it comes to the kids, there are we've got lots of tips and advice actually on digitalawarenessuk.com that people can access.
It's a global problem, as we see there, even in Massachusetts. So go back to Janelle. I mean, in terms of your contract. Within this survey, 32% of youngsters said their parents had no idea that they were using their phones whilst they're upstairs supposedly sleeping. In your particular case with your son, have there been occasions where you've caught him?
Well, here's the thing. So now my son is 16, but I also have a 14-year-old, a 12-year-old, a 10-year-old, and an 8-year-old. So I'm absolutely fully aware of how much work it is to manage the technology and to be parenting in the modern world. And with that, we have to set these boundaries, but we have to do that contract that we make, that has to be a living, breathing agreement that we revisit on a regular basis, that we modify as our kids grow and change. So certainly making mistakes and testing boundaries are absolutely appropriate for childhood development in all different ways and shapes. So how do we learn from those mistakes? How do we correct that? And how do we come from a place that this isn't just do what I say? It's a little more information, like this is why I think it's important, exactly to the point of modeling, of setting that example, and having the points in our contracts shouldn't look exactly alike because all families are different. But how do we make these points that support our families as individuals and each of our children?
Janelle, I am full of admiration. You could become a contract lawyer, it sounds, at redoing contracts and contracts for all the different kids. And we're terribly grateful for your time. It's absolutely fascinating. I've loved talking to you, and Emma Robertson and Mike Buchanan as well. Thanks, all of you.
Thank you.